His love endures forever. For he is good, he is above all things. His love endures forever. Sing praise, sing praise. With a mighty hand and outstretched arm, his love endures forever. For the life that's been reborn, his love endures forever. Sing praise, sing praise, sing praise, sing praise. Forever God is faithful, forever God is strong, forever God is with us. Stay in the garden with him, though the but he bids me go through the voice of woe. His voice to me is calling, and he walks with me, and he talks with me, and he tells me I am his own, and the joy we share as we tarry, none other has ever
Well, good evening. Didn't think I'd be here tonight, but God is gracious. He made it rain, and I got out early. So it was all up to him, and he did what he needed to do. It's kind of interesting because 3 weeks ago I spoke on living in the rewards of the Lord, and you know, as I was sitting down, I said, Lord, I you know, do you want me to go back to that, or do you want me to use something that I had written and never got to use? He goes, nope, I want you to go back to that. So first thing I'm going to have you do is open to 2 Peter 1. 2 Peter 1. Now, I know 2 Peter is in here. Peter, right there. Excuse me. There's 1 Peter, 2 Peter. Father, we come before you, Lord Jesus. I thank you, Father, for every opportunity you have given me this week to share your word. Father, your word is so powerful, Father. And when it's done in the expression of unconditional love rather than rage, it really pricks the heart. And so, Father, again, I thank you for the week that my family was here, Father, as we sat outside on the porch and just shared your word. Every morning when we drank coffee, Father, it was just a great time. And Lord, I thank you for the time that you've given me at camp, Father, just to share, not even knowing when or what, but just to reveal your life that I have chosen to live within me. Father, we thank you, Lord. We love you, Father. And Lord, just open the eyes and ears of our hearts so that we may receive your word tonight, Father. We thank you, Lord, and we praise you. In your precious name we pray. Amen. Now, I'm not going to 2 Peter 1 yet, but I will get there in a minute. Because I'm going to 2 Peter 1, 17 and 19 of the verses I'm going to use. So it's kind of interesting because I've always revealed my faith. It's something I can't hide. I owe my life to the Lord. So because he saved me, because I accepted what he have and received him into my heart, I allowed pleroma to flourish within my heart. Now, the last time I was up here 3 weeks ago, I think, I spoke on pleroma faith. And pleroma fills up every empty place where the deficiency in a man are. So let's say I've only taken a piece of the Word of God, all right? And I don't know the Word of God because I'm a brand new Christian, but by faith, and I'll give you an illustration of this, by faith, I give everything to the Lord by faith. I repent of my sin. I give absolutely every waking part of my being to Christ. Now, it's kind of interesting because a young man called me this week, or not called me, but, you know, texted me and said, good morning, Pastor Mark. And the Lord said, I want you to just to tell him you're praying that God would just show his realness to this young man. And so I said to this young man, I'm praying for you today. I'm praying that God would reveal his spirit to you in an amazing way. Well, I got a text this just a little while ago before I got here. Wow, you're never going to believe what happened. I got a job to do, and this job led to another job. And he said, I was just obedient and going in prayer to the Lord and saying, Lord, you know what I need, and I'm trusting you for it. And he said, you know what happened? Within an hour, bam, he said he answered that prayer, see? And again, you know, there's struggles in people. But when we lay it all out for the Lord, and I mean lay it all out, don't just give him a piece of it, but lay it entirely out before the Lord in pleroma faith, allowing it to fill in every aspect of the heart where there is a deficiency. See, and that pleroma faith will come into that. Now there's Christians today have a mandate, right? And that mandate is to grow into the fullness of God's word. It's kind of amazing. We are given so much prophetic wisdom from the Old Testament that honestly, we should not be surprised at what's going on, because there's so much reality in the prophetic word of God in the Old Testament that we shouldn't even be going, I can't believe this is happening. I can believe it's happening because the word of God says it's going to happen. Why? Because the hearts of his people grow cold. Do you really think that God wanted the Israelites in the wilderness for 40 years? No, it's because they couldn't get their heads out of their rear ends long enough to figure out that everything they were doing was wrong. It was wrong. Well, I'll just, you know, I'm going to complain, I'm going to whine, I'm going to moan, I'm going to argue. I'm going to argue with God. Come on now. You're going to argue with God? What kind of ridiculousness is that? You know, that's futile. That's futile arguing with God, because his plan, his will, his way will be done. So 2 Peter 1:17, 19 tells me this. It says, for we did not follow cleverly contrived myths when we made known to you the power and coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. We were eyewitnesses of his majesty, for he received honor and glory from God the Father when the voice came to him from the majestic glory saying, this is my beloved Son, with whom I am well pleased. Now that was at the Mount of Transfigurations. And Peter saw this, again, this amazing white remnant of who God was. And Peter went, wow, that's pretty cool. See? We ourselves heard this voice when it came from heaven while we were with him on the holy mountain, who also have the prophetic word strongly confirmed. And you will do well to pay attention to it. As to a lamp shining in a dark place until the day dawns and the morning star rises in your heart. That morning star, by the way, is the life of Christ. See, that's the morning star. The morning star order is the group of people that lived entirely by faith. See? By faith. Not faith after redemption, faith after salvation, faith after being redeemed and set free from the bondage of sin and slavery. That's what they were set free from. Now, they're part of the Morning Star Order. They have risen up in a very dark place, and they are shining brightly the life of Christ, no matter what. It's kind of interesting, because last year, this is one of the stories, last year I had a friend of mine at camp who has been there for many, many years, lost some toes to diabetes. And it was kind of interesting because his wife works at the camp, and every morning that I would show up, I would say, "How, I'm not going to mention his name, how's such and such doing? Would you please let him know we're praying for him?" And she goes, "Really?" I go, "Yeah." She goes, "But why?" I said, "Because he's a child of God." I said, "And because, you know, Jesus died for him." And now I've got to tell you, he's Jewish. He's a Jewish guy. All right? So throughout this process of saying that every day, right up to the end of the camp, I said, how is he doing? "Oh, he's doing much better. I told him you were praying for him." He said, "He can't believe you're praying for him." And I said, "Why wouldn't I?" And so I came back this year, and the first person I saw was this person. And he came running up, and he said, "I got to tell you something. He said, I got to show you something." I said, "What is it?" He goes, "This." And he pulls back his shirt, and tattooed right here, he has the Star of David and the cross intertwined in it. And I said, "Can I ask you something?" He goes, "You're gonna." I said, "I know I am." I said, "You received Christ as your Savior." He said, "I gave him all my heart." Now, I'm not sure how long it was, but shortly in one of the series this year, after we got back from New Jersey, I said, we have to be able to take God's word to God's children and reveal to them the Messiah, the Savior of Christ. It's Christ the Savior. We've got to be able to do that. See? That's one of the reasons we are called to bring the word forth. Now, it's kind of interesting because he's sitting there going, "I watch you all the time. I watch your message all the time." He lives in New Jersey. And I went, "Wow, that's just fantastic." And he goes, "You know what?" He says, "My wife got saved." And he said, "By the way, this is my son. My son got saved." He said, "You can't even understand what you've done to my family." I said, "I haven't done anything." I said, "I just am faithful, living in pleroma faith, giving the Lord everything and not worrying about it. Because I am his and he is mine, and he has told me that to just be who he has called me to be." There was no screaming, no yelling, no saying, "You're a sinner, rah, rah, rah." Yeah. No, you know what it was? It was just saying, "You know what? I'm praying for you. I'm praying for you." Very humbly, very contrite, not raising my voice, nothing. Just revealing the unconditional love of God for one of his children that, well, got lost. So, again, we have this word of prophecy. And the word of prophecy, we should understand that the time is so short and our mission time is so short that we need to be going and bringing the good news of Christ to those that are lost and dying in this world. You know, it's kind of interesting because there was a young man on the bus today, and he gets up and stops, and he goes, "You've been here a long time, haven't you?" I said, "Yeah." He said, "You're the preacher bus driver." I said, "Yep, I am." He goes, "You pray every time we take off, don't you?" I go, "Yes, we do." I said, "Yes, all the time." And he goes, "You know, thank you." Again, another Jewish young man. I said, "Well, you know something." I said, "You know the Father, but I know the Son. And the Son wants to get to know you." And he goes, "Whose Son?" And I said, "God's Son." I said, "But I think I'll have you on a trip, so I'll talk to you later." because I get one-on-one time when we go trips, you know, I'll sit next to somebody and talk to them. And so we know what we need to do, and we know how to do it, see? And we do it in pleroma faith, in that faith that takes every single place where we think we're deficient and fills it with the light of Christ, see? Now, there's a word, and it's the word metabolized, all right? Now, metabolized in the Greek, it's the word metaskematzo, metaskematizo. And it means a change that is brought about after the effect of something. And this is another story. I'm sitting in another camp yesterday. It's 90-something degrees down in the bus in the valley surrounded by trees. And this lady pulls up and goes, "You can come up to the top of the hill. There's a wonderful breeze there." I said, "Oh, thank you very much." So I get out of the bus and I walked up the hill and I sat on the porch and there's wonderful breeze blowing through there. I'm sitting there probably about 10, 15 minutes. And this young man from another camp, not even the one that we're at and not even the one that I drove over, but another camp, walking across the grass, just kind of looking like this, and he's looking down on the ground, and he stops, and he picks something up, and he keeps walking, and then he sees me, and he goes, "Oh, hi." I go, "Hi." I said, "What are you picking up?" He goes, "Hearts." I go, "Hearts." He goes, "Yeah." He says, I find them all the time." This is a kid that's 8 years old. I go, "Really?" I said, "My wife finds hearts all the time." I said, "We've got a wheelbarrow full in the house." I said, "Wherever she goes, she finds a heart." I said, "Do you know what that heart means?" He goes, "No, I just like him." I said, "It means that God loves you." And he stops. And he goes, "Really?" I go, "Yeah, it means that God loves you." And he's revealing his love through those hearts that you find. And he reaches into his, now the kid's supposed to be playing lacrosse, reaches into his, going to take a bathroom break, reaches into his pocket and pulls out like 15 rocks. I go, "Doesn't that slow you down a little bit?" He goes, "A little." They were all hearts. And I go, "You know what?" I said, "Again, my wife calls those hearts of love from God." And I said, "You know, God so loved the world that he gave his only son so that you and I may have a provision to be saved." And I mean, he's sitting there listening to this. And he goes, "Really?" I said, "Yeah." And I said, "So you know God loves you by the hearts." And I said, "Now you know that God gave his only begotten son, Jesus Christ, to die for you on the cross for your sins so that you could have everlasting life. And all you have to do is receive him." 8 years old. He goes, "How do I do that?" I go, "Let's pray." So we prayed the sinner's prayer right there on the top of that little hill with the breeze blowing and his pocket full of hearts. And then he went to the bathroom. And then he came back out and he said, "I'm glad I met you today." And I said, "I'm glad I came up to the top of this hill and sat down." He goes, "You're from Tuckahoe." I go, "Yes, I am." He goes, "I'm sure we'll see each other again." I said, "I'm counting on it." And so, you know, it's just, We live in that place, and we let the morning star shine within us. And you know what happens? It radiates out and becomes an attractant rather than something that offends people and sets them off. Living in the faithfulness of the rewards of God. So you know what? This kid, after he came out of the bed, he's running and he's smiling. Something happened. There was a change in that young boy. See? In most cases, it would be the after effect of transformation that comes with receiving Christ through repentance. You know what's funny? In all of these camps, there's an underlying of Christianity. There's an underlying of Christianity. And it's kind of interesting because, again, I'm the pastor at Camp Tuckahoe that prays every time the buses leave. And other bus drivers know he's the guy that prays. He's the pastor. My friend got on the bus today, and he looked at me, and he said to the guys on the bus, he goes, "You respect this man because he's a man of God." It's not hidden. It's not hidden. See? This little light of mine, I'm going to let it shine. That is the morning star. That's pleroma. See? That's the life of Christ metabolized into a flesh body, revealing the light and life of Christ. I don't have to make it come out. It just shines. And that's what the Lord has called. Just let your light shine. Be that city on a hill. See? It begins in the inward. This metaschemazo begins in the inward. It begins inward. There's a definitive change in the heart and in the soul, which translates to the mind as it grows. But it begins in the heart. There's a transformation of the heart. Remember, the heart is wicked and the mind is deceitful. When Christ comes in, there is a transformation. And that transformation comes from asking the Lord to forgive you of your lunacy living in the sin nature and in the flesh. So it begins in the inward, then becomes an outward expression that reveals an outward appearance of who Christ is. Of who Christ is. When Peter saw Jesus, and we read that verse, when Peter saw Jesus, he saw Jesus in a raiment white as light. What do you reveal to others around you? That's the first question. What do you reveal to others around you? Do you reveal the morning star of Christ within you? Or do you reveal somebody who's, well, not put together, not revealing Christ, not living in the example or the character or the nature or the act of the Savior? What is seen? What is seen? Turn with me to Matthew 17. Matthew 17. These have inward tabs on this, this one. Matthew 17, verse 2. After 6 days, I'm going to verse 1. After 6 days, Jesus took Peter, James, and his brother John and led them up on a high mountain by themselves. He was transfigured in front of them, and his face shone like the sun. His clothes became white as the light. Suddenly, Moses and Elijah appeared to them, talking with him. Then Peter said to Jesus, "Lord, it's good for us to be here. If you want," I love Peter, "if you want, I will set up 3 shelters here, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." While he was still speaking, suddenly a bright cloud over them, and a voice from the cloud said, again, this is 2 Peter 1:17 as well. A voice came over him. "This is my beloved son, with whom I am well pleased. Listen to him." And when the disciples heard this, they fell face down and were terrified. You know how many people don't listen to the Spirit when he speaks? They come up, with an agenda, or they take one verse and they pound the living daylights out of it, instead of living in the fullness of pleroma and believing the full counsel of God. See, the full counsel of God. And it's kind of interesting because, you know, some people get very angry because they don't want to live by the full counsel of God. They want to live in one verse because they can bend that verse to validate an agenda. That's not pleroma faith. That's leaving the dark places dark and putting a little dim bulb on one part of your heart. And that's so the rest of your sin nature can't be revealed. Because if it was, see, that's what's going to be on display. See? And that's why it is so important to have a full understanding of the Word of God, not just hit and miss verses that just confuse and cast out doubt, keeping folks from the fullness of pleroma. See, we see this in churches all across the country today. We are watching pastors fall. Oh, we are watching pastors fall all over the place because they have kept their flock in stagnicity and in bondage because they're hitting them with one thing. See, again, what does the Bible say? Live in the fullness of the Word of God. Live in the fullness of grace. Live in the fullness of mercy. Live in the fullness of unconditional love. See? Live in those things. Live in the fullness of who Christ is in you. See? What is a pleroma believer? Ready for this? One that is broken, one that is humble, one that is contrite, one that lives in absolute humility, that know not a single thing can separate them from the love of God. That's pleroma faith. Thunder may thunder, lightning may flash, floods may come, all hell may break loose, but they know that they are still loved unconditionally by God. And they know that when they come back to him in humility and brokenness and contriteness, he will say, welcome home. Welcome home. See, that's pleroma faith. That's pleroma faith. The pleroma believer increases the body of Christ through evangelism, revealing the love of the Father as well as the Son, rather than decreasing the acceptance through confusion. See, where does confusion come from? Right straight from the pit of hell. That's where confusion comes from. See? But in pleroma, we are not confusing, we are leading. It's funny because I explained to this 8-year-old boy, there was no confusion. He went, oh, I understand. It's funny that an 8-year-old boy can understand, but when you get in your 30s, 40s, 50s, and 60s, you're like, what? I don't understand it. Because you're thinking too much into it. You're thinking way too much into it. This little boy, childlike faith. Oh, really, those hearts. Are God revealing his love for me? Yeah. Really? And your wife picks him up? Yeah, all the time. He goes, huh. Well, that's interesting. You want to receive Jesus? Because God loved you so much, he gave his son, his only son. No confusion. Just acceptance for the love of Christ. It's funny because another person came up to me as they saw me talking to them, and they stopped in their golf cart and they were just listening. And I think it was one of the leaders of the camp that we were at. And as the little boy runs in the bathroom, he looks at me and he goes, that was awesome. I go, it was, wasn't it? So we don't have to listen to that. So decreasing the acceptance through confusion because they're not living in pleroma faith. I love the phrase, and I love this phrase, victorious winner. Victorious winner. You know, it's funny. Because every time we have a victory, the enemy gets wicked upset. He gets really ticked off. You know, and you know the funny thing? Whatever, your reign is short. Go back into the hole you crawled out of, put your pajamas back on, and go to sleep. Because I'm going to live in the victory of God. So who are victorious winners? They're the ones that lay up eternal treasures. They lay up eternal treasures. They don't just talk the talk, they walk the walk, they get it done. They're the ones that lay up eternal treasures. They lay up eternal treasures through a life of faith obedience here on earth. Faith obedience here on earth. It's so funny. That young man who said, "Wow, I can't believe what happened." I said, "You were obedient. You weren't distracted by the things around you. You stayed focused." Because, again, I got a text early in the week, "Please pray for me, it's hard." And I go, "That's what makes it nice. That's what makes it Christ-like. It's hard." And I said, "The Lord didn't say it's going to be a cakewalk. He said it was going to be difficult. There'd be mountains to climb, valleys to crawl in. But you know what? At every mountain, he's there. And in every valley, he's there. Because grace flows down the mountain. You just have to be obedient to him." So again, victorious winners are the ones that lay up eternal treasures through a life of faith obedience here on earth, allowing pleroma to take full resident in every single aspect of their lives. Every single aspect. A pleroma believer reveals the very nature of the Father, which fills up all things in the personal nation of the universe, as well as the national nation in the universe. What is that? Eternity. See? Store up your treasures in heaven. See? Eternal treasures. Live in an eternal purpose here on earth, gathering eternal treasures for heaven. And, you know, we talked about that last Sunday. In that book of remembrance, tested by fire. I want to turn to Ephesians 4:16, because this is important. I love the people that say, "Oh, you don't have to go to church." A pleroma believer, let me go there. Yep, 4:16. I got to find it now. I just had it a minute ago. Where did it go? That's always the last one. Corinthians, Ephesians. Oh, come now, where are you? Oh, maybe I'm in the... Yeah, it should be right there. Yeah. There it is. All right, Ephesians 4:16. I'm using my other Bible. And let's see, I'm gonna go to 15. Nah, we'll go to 14. We'll go to 4:14. No, we won't. Let's go to 11. "And he himself gave some to be apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, some pastors and teachers, to equip the saints for the work of ministry, to build up the body of Christ, until we all reach unity in the faith and in the knowledge of God's Son, growing into maturity with a stature measured by the fullness of Christ." There it is, by Christ's fullness. That's how it's measured, by Christ's fullness. "Then we will no longer be little children, throwing a temper tantrum, throwing our toys across the room, screaming and yelling, acting like a lunatic, tossed by the waves." I added all those other things. tossed by the waves and blown around by every wind of teaching, by human cunning with cleverness in the techniques of deceit. If you're not full of pleroma, you're full of deceit. But speaking the truth in love, see, in love, let us grow in every way into Him who is the head. Him who is the head. And that would be Christ. From Him, Christ, the whole body fitted and knit together by every supporting ligament promotes the growth of the body for building itself up in love by the proper working of each individual part. So what does a pleroma believer reveal? The nature of the Father which fills up all things in the personal nation of the universe, as well as the national universe, but also believes and understands in the local assembly principles. The local assembly principles. What are those? Gathering together. The Lord has called us to gather together, to edify and build up each other, not tear down. Iron sharpens iron. And what happens? The body grows stronger. It's kind of interesting because, again, if we're missing part of the body, then the body's missing a piece. Do you know if you lose your big toe, your balance is thrown off? Your balance is really thrown off. So the local assembly principle is the local assembly becomes the light and life of Christ for the nation. All the churches that live in pleroma faith are shining the morning star, and in the morning star, which are the people that live in pleroma faith, what happens? They become the light. See? They become the light. And so that light does what? It shines. It shines. It doesn't even have to be forced to be lit. It just shines. Why? Because we're living in the fullness of who He is. Not just one individual single thing, but everything. The fullness of the complete and absolute Word of God. That's pleroma. And you know what happens in that? We begin to live in the rewards, the blessings of the rewards we receive. Because we have an understanding what they are based upon our acts and character. See? By faith. By faith. And so, you know, as we go into this study a little bit more, we'll be talking a little bit more about this. But choose to live in that pleroma faith. In that faith that comes in and fills all the dark places. All the dark places. You know, when the morning star order comes, you will know who they are in heaven because they will shine amazingly bright. And you know what the morning star order has? Authority. And the morning star is Jesus Christ. And so let's live in the authority of the morning star and shine brighter than we've ever shined before. Father, we thank You for this message, Lord Jesus. Father, we thank You for Your unconditional love and Your mercy, Father, and to those folks, Father, that You have allowed me to understand why I am in this camp, Father, and why I am doing what You have called me to do, Lord. Thank You, Father, for reminding me that a month and a half ago when I said, I don't know if I want to do this, Lord, and You said, yes, this is where I need You. Father, and You needed me there yesterday, Father. Thank You. If you've never received Jesus Christ, if you've never repented of your sins, if you've never asked Jesus Christ to be a part of your life, you need to. You need to today. When we ask Christ in our heart, not because we're doing it because a pastor says it, but we're doing it because we know we need to repent of living the way that we live and living for Christ. And when we ask Christ into our heart, Revelation says, I stand at the door and knock. Will you let him in? Will you let him in? See, you got to open the door. There's no handle on the outside. He doesn't push his way in. You have to open the door and receive him. I remember we did a big study on reception. So there's a prayer. Some people don't like this prayer. I really don't care. You know, I studied this prayer out. There's probably like 17 verses that put this prayer together, the sinner's prayer. And Revelations is just a small part of it. But tonight, if you want transformation, if you want to experience something that is different than you ever experienced before, then you have to say these words to the Lord. Father, no, stop. Lord Jesus. Lord Jesus, forgive me for living and violating the way that you have called me to live. Lord Jesus, come into my heart, Lord. Come into my heart. Wash me clean, Father. Take away all of the crap that I've gathered and transform my heart, Father. Redeem it. Lord Jesus, forgive me. Forgive me for living against you. Transform my life, Father. Wash me white as snow with the blood of the Lamb, Father. Wash me white as snow. Lord Jesus, redeem me. Redeem me. I know, Lord, the word says you will make us righteous. Righteous. If we receive you. Father, I am receiving your gift of salvation tonight, Father. Sanctify me, Father. Reveal your plan for my life, Lord Jesus. Reveal it, Father. Begin to burn brightly in me. Thank you. Thank you, Father. Now, if you said that prayer, I would love to hear from you. You know, it's kind of funny because, you know, this young man that I've been talking to, he goes, man, he goes, it's tough. I said, yeah, it is. I said, but you have to let him all the way in. You can't just keep him, you just can't keep him in the breezeway on the mat. You just can't keep him in the breezeway. You got to let him all in. You got to let him into the kitchen. You got to let him into the bathroom. You got to let him into the bedroom. You got to let him into the living room. You got to let him into the basement. You got to let him everywhere. You got to let him fill this house. Fill this house. Father, we thank you, Lord Jesus, for this message, Father. Just so quick, so fast. I love it. Father, but directly, accurately to the point. Father, we thank you, Lord Jesus. Father, again, I thank you for the time that I got to spend with my family, Father, just revealing the life of Christ to them and their friends, Father, and just watching them, Lord, as they shine forth with new information, Father, that brought fullness into their lives. Lord Jesus, we thank you, Father. We love you and praise you. Bless all those young men at that camp, Father. Just be with their leaders, Father. Give their leaders courage to direct them and discipline in the way they should go, Father. Lord Jesus, keep the other driver safe. Keep me safe, Father, as we get ready to even get busier and go on long-distance trips, Father. We thank you, Lord. We love you, and we praise you, Father. In your precious name we pray, amen.